Okay, I'm Scott Cowling. I work on the HPSDR project, and I'm on the board at Tapper. This will be about HPSDR. Tapper was earlier, however, at Tapper booth, and down here I have handouts on HPSDR. If you don't have one, feel free to come take one, or stop by the Tapper booth. Also at the Tapper booth, this is what we're going to talk about right now. This is the board set and the back plane. We also have these on display, a couple stations. You can actually make a QSO between two stations we have set up at the Tapper booth, 455 through 458. Okay, I started to take a look at doing this presentation, thinking this should be pretty easy, 15 minutes, no problem. And then I started looking at what we've accomplished in the last year and where we're at. It's going to go fast, so I'm going to go pretty fast at the beginning and try to focus a little later on the stuff you probably came here to see about, hear about. You all know about what HPSDR is, hopefully, or most of you do. So for the ones that do, bear with me. For the ones that don't, try not to get too overwhelmed. I'm going to go fast, but the data's up on the web page. Come by the Tapper booth. We'll talk to you and fill in any questions that you might have. So anybody who doesn't know what this next two seconds are, don't worry. You haven't missed anything. Feel lucky. Contrary to some rumors, we have not left the building. We are here. HPSDR is alive. We're progressing, and we're going to be here for a long time. So now, how to tell if you might be an HPSDR, an SDR addict? Well, this is a picture of my backyard. It doesn't look like this anymore, but it did for a long time. So, and I hope yours doesn't look like that. Okay, and Lyle covered this a lot in his slide, so I won't dwell on this. But just to denote the difference between an SDR, a software-defined radio, and a software-controlled radio, or an IF-DSP radio. The primary functionality, in other words, modulation, filtering, et cetera, is defined in software. And that's, again, like Lyle says, it doesn't mean it's a PC, it just means it's in software, and maybe in a little bit of it in firmware, too, FPGAs, et cetera. Best-known examples, Flex Radio Systems radios. How many of you know about Tony Parks' Soft Rocks? Oh, wow, everybody, okay. Some reason why he sold 11,000 of them. Okay, this is what HPSDR is about. High performance, open source model, modular expandable, note the backplane and modular boards and plug-in boards. And mostly, I think, is as exciting as advancing the state of the radio art. I mean, when I came here to Dayton a couple of years ago and saw SDR for the first time, it was actually Gerald's presentation. Finally gave me a reason to do SDR. Hey, it works better. So it's not just, you don't have to do SDR just because it's just different, it's better. So what's the HPSDR project? Modular open source hardware. A group of volunteers. As of last count, I was over 900 on the open HPSDR list. And Tapper's mission, this is a little plug for Tapper in here. We want to support the HPSDR project with funding to do prototypes, alpha PCBs. You guys out there are going to be designing the stuff. You shouldn't have to buy the hardware too. We should try to help you do that. And early volume production, you'd be surprised at how fast the project advances when 500 guys all have hardware. So the result is an ever-growing pool of contributors. You're going to get a lot more contributors if there's 500 boards in people's hands than if there's three. Or if I tell you, okay, you can build a board, but you have to go buy all the parts, and you have to put it all together, and you have to write all the software. Well, okay, that's all parallel paths. It's not built on each other. So HPSDR and Tapper are separate. They complement each other. HPSDR provides the expertise and the projects and the ideas and the design expertise. Tapper facilitates. AMSAT helps out here too. They support the HPSDR project with tools that they have managed to negotiate licenses for. So for instance, if you want to do a project, you want to build a board, do you really have $5,000 to spend on schematic capture software? Most of us don't. And if you had $5,000, you could buy a Flex radio and an HPSDR. So do that. And a K3. Okay, so AMSAT supports us with some SMT rear work equipment. So for building prototypes, we have a little bit of equipment that no normal person here, well, that's probably a bad thing to say, but most people wouldn't have SMT rear work equipment in their basement. And they also support us financially in the beginning, especially when we are short on cash. If you know, as you know, these boards are expensive. When you build 500 of something that costs $200, do the math. We don't have that much money laying around. So AMSAT helps us with a little bit of financial support in the beginning. Okay, so the boards. Quick review. These are the ones you already know about. Atlas, the backplane. Pinocchio, the extender, which I think Tapper sold like 600 of these. I still don't have any idea why you'd want one, but hey, it's only like 20 bucks, so it's cool. Ozymandias, or Ozzy, the USB gateway. That's the connection to the computer. Janus is the baseband A to D and D to A to converter. Now, does it spell a popular rumor? You do not need a Janus board to use the transmitter receiver boards that are Penelope and Mercury. That is an audio card. That's for like if you want to plug your soft rock in and listen to some baseband IQ source and display it and listen to it. Okay, Penelope, transmitter, Mercury, direct sampling receiver. Okay, now as Lyle said, I believe it was Lyle said, and Gerald referred to it too, these are direct up conversion and direct sampling. So this is the A to D connected to the antenna. This is the D to A connected to the antenna. And then finally, the LPU, sort of a stopgap power unit, so you don't have to use a switching power supply that compromises your minus 140 dBm sensitive receiver. Okay, some new additions. Penny Whistle, 20-watt PA. It's a linear PA, very small little board, runs on 12 volts. We have the alpha unit at the Tapper booth. Come by and take a look at it. Alex board. This is a set of bandpass filter boards. We actually have a low-pass and a high-pass board. You gang them together, you get bandpass. So you use the low-pass filter board for your transmitter. Now, Penelope transmitter is clean enough with our synthesis techniques that you do not need to have any filtering on the transmitter. However, when you add a PA, you get a little bit of distortion, so you really need a low-pass filter. So that's what this board provides, this board set provides. And of course, if you happen to live next to the Voice of America and you don't like to hear them on every frequency, well, you might want a little bit of low-pass filter or high-pass filtering too. So, this also provides a lot of other features, as you'll see in a minute, like TR switching, a 6-meter preamp, multiple receive antennas, transverter connections, things like that. These are all the things that you need that you already get in the box if you buy a Flex radio. But if you buy that, you don't have that, so you need to add these things to have a working system. Excalibur, for those of you who like to call WWV and tell them they're off frequency. Use this. Also, if you want to get on 75 and argue with the guys about their 756 transmitter, it's off frequency, you can use Excalibur. Pandora is the enclosure, new enclosure. We've got samples of that. We've got two proto units at the Tapper booth. You can come by and see that. We also have an Excalibur alpha unit, too. And GERD in Germany, DJ8AY, has some additions, too. He has a 3-slot backplane. So if you want just a transmitter receiver, so Ozzy board, Penelope Mercury, and that's all you want in your system, you can buy a 3-slot backplane, little bitty thing. And he also has an antenna switch and a 6-meter low nose amplifier, and I got a sample of it up here, so I have some pictures too. So this will be back at the Tapper booth if you want to take a look at it. Okay, also coming soon, GERD has a 100-watt PA he's working on. He optimistically told me it'd be out by the end of next month. I think that's a little optimistic, but we'll see. Hermes is a combination of a Penelope, a Mercury, and an Ozzy all on one board. That's basically what that is. And Kevin, M0KHC, who is working on it, he claims he's going to put a Penny Whistle 20-watt PA on this board too. And so I told him he's got the TARDIS model that has like 30 square inches here, and he puts 80 square inches of parts on it. So I want to see how he does this. The Phoenix is a QSD, QSE receiver transmitter all on one board. That's currently undergoing alpha testing. It has a synthesizer on it, and they're having a little problem with noise spurs on the synthesizer, so they're working on that right now. Odyssey, low power handheld SDR. This is also known as the SUTSAT project, which I'll get to in a little bit. As I progress down the list here, these are less and less defined, so you'll see this as we go through it. Thor High Efficiency Class EPA, this is kind of what we wanted, and Penny Whistle is kind of what we have now because we can make that. It's quick and easy. This is going to be a High Efficiency Class E switcher type power amplifier. On the 100 to 300 watt range, they haven't really decided. They're still talking about it. Gibraltar is a GPS discipline frequency standard. Again, the back up here. Excalibur is kind of like a poor man's version, subset of it. Okay, so again, Demeter is a full-featured power supply. Again, the LPU is the simple analog one. This is going to be a low-noise switcher one, and it has been discussed for over 18 months, so we'll see how that actually progresses. Sasquatch is a DSP backend, and actually, I'd like to see this. This would allow you to use an HPSDR with no PC. So it would provide you the knobs and buttons and a little display and the processing that the PC does now, so you won't have to use PC. Not trivial task, by the way. Okay, I'm going to go through these fast. Atlas backplane, these are the quantities that we've made. Current status right now, there's about 50 parts kits available from Tapper. Pinocchio extender, about 70 kits available, so you can still buy those. So the Aussie board. This is the USB interface, so USB connector up here. Incidentally, this is the parallel I/O connector. You can use this to control your SDR1000 if you have one of those, so interesting dual use. Okay, the problem with these is we have no more assembled boards. We're working on it. We're not there yet. However, you can buy for the Brave, there's 250 bare boards available. If you like soldering small leads, there's plenty of them on Aussie for you. Janus, this is the baseband sound card. You can use this with soft rock. Anything that produces IQ audio, you can feed in here and you can use this. And we have plenty of these, about 100 boards available, and some bare boards if you're adventurous. Penelope, half-watt transmitter. You've seen this. This was out before last Dayton. Tapper built 350 of these. And plus 50 bare boards, and currently all the Tapper boards are sold out. However, GERD is building these boards in Germany, and you can order these today. So never fear, you can get a transmitter to go with your receiver. Mercury, this is the latest, this came out about December of 08. It's the latest board in the set. And again, you saw these at, if you went to DCC, you saw these kind of specs. Very good low sensitivity. Basically, ADC overload is what limits you. There is an onboard preamplifier, 20 dB preamplifier, that you can switch in and out using PowerSDR. And currently, we have about 85 of these available, so no problem getting these either. Okay, latest edition, and this just started shipping about 2 weeks ago. Linear power unit. It's this guy right here on the end. Basically allows you to run the radio off your station supply. So everybody here has a 12-volt regulated supply, right? So we don't have to redesign that and run AC in and get all that 60 hertz and junk in your nice sensitive receiver box. So we'll just run 12 volts in from your station supply, and we'll supply just enough for you to run your Penelope, Mercury, and Aussie board. And then when Demeter comes out, hopefully sometime, you'll be able to use that instead of this. But one of the things that's interesting is that there is a switcher on here to get you your minus 12 volts. We put a jumper on there to disable that. So if you put the jumper on there, you get no minus 12 volts, but you get absolutely no oscillators, no switching noise, nothing. Quiet power supply. And incidentally, the Penelope, Mercury, and Aussie do not require the minus 12. So the Janus needs minus 12. So if you don't have a Janus in your system, you can put that jumper on and sleep well at night. So this is released. There's about 280 kits. We bought a lot of extra PC boards, so they'll either be PC boards for you to roll your own, or we'll kit up some more. This is pretty pretty massive, too, because the kitting guys kitted up 500 of these kits. Took them about 4 sessions to do this. So when I say additional kits likely if needed, maybe it's just we talk nicely to the guys who did the kitting. Okay, here's the PA. Again, there's an example of this over at the Tapper booth. This heatsink is most likely not the one we're going to use. We're going to use a custom one that is the full length of this. This will fit inside the enclosure, by the way, so when it comes out, you'll be able to use it. So nominal 20 watts, 16 watts PEP. Nominal drive requirement was picked for a reason. Penelope will drive it. Runs on basically your 13.6 passes through the LPU to operate that. 160 through 6, about 20 dB again, a little bit less. But it does require a low-pass filter, such as Alex, maybe. Okay, so here's a graph of your power output versus frequency. It does drop a little bit towards 6 meters. Okay, and currently this is, we're right about this phase right here. Look for the show of interest in a week or two after Dayton, after we catch our breath. And the tentative run for June, maybe. Next, Alex. And you saw this last year. There was a long story. I kind of expoused upon that this morning at the Tapper Forum. We're having a lot of trouble with these toroids. There's a lot of them. There's 38 per board set. We would really like to manufacture this and test it so you get a working system. Well, if I leave the toroids out, I can't test it. So we're working on getting a good source of those. I think we got this licked. So look for this maybe around DCC timeframe in September. You'll be able to place orders before that, but delivery probably won't be before September. And again, this is a very useful board. This is the board set features. And I'm not going to go through all this. You can come by the booth and I'll answer any of your questions. Or you can go to the openhpsdr.org website and you can get more information you could possibly want there. Now this is the TXLPF features. And this is, incidentally, you can select these with PowerSDR, so you can still use these even though you're running SWL, if you're listening to shortwave. And it's rated at 100 watts, too, so when the higher power amp comes out, you don't have to lose this board. There'll be a quiz on this chart later. Okay, this is the TXLPF board. Okay, now the receiver board. Similar, only high-pass filters instead of low-pass filters. And you've got multiple antenna inputs. You've got a 6-meter low-noise amplifier, or you can bypass that. Gives you a nice anti-aliasing low-pass filter, too, for the Mercury board or for any other board. I like this sports set because it's useful for lots of QRP or homebrew applications. Doesn't have to be used just for HPSDR. And there's the block diagram of the receiver board. And there's a picture of it. And again, we have a prototype of this in the Tapper booth if you want to take a look at it. And you can see they actually did 3 alphas. This is why it's taken so long, 3 alphas. They wanted to get it right. Off-the-shelf enclosure, so you won't have to deal with any of that problem. And scheduled for summer to fall for this one. Okay, 10 megahertz clock reference. This here is a TCXO. It also has an external 10 megahertz input from a GPS. So if you're a frequency fanatic, you can get right on frequency, or you can get pretty close to on frequency with the onboard TCXO. And the interesting thing is there's some LEDs up here in the corner. I'm not sure exactly where they are, if they're over here or over here. What you can do is you can feed your GPS in and you can tweak the TCXO until the LEDs balance, and then you know you've adjusted your TCXO to your GPS. And then you're only at the mercy of the drift of this. So you can tweak it right in. If you notice, this is a little half high board. Okay, and quick specs. Sine and square wave sources on or onboard TCXO. And you get these outputs are simultaneous too. So for instance, if you wanted to sync up your frequency counter with 10 megahertz, you can do this. So you can daisy chain all your equipment together. And this is an example of a 3-day drift profile. These divisions here are 1 hertz out of your 10 megahertz. These divisions here are 12 hours. So you can see you get about a tenth of a PPM here. 1 hertz, plus or minus 1 hertz out of 10 megahertz. I know for some of you guys that's not enough, so you'll need a GPS. Okay, where are we at with this? Show of interest, this is almost identical to Penelope's schedule, so the show of interest should be forthcoming momentarily. Kidding runs tentatively the same time. And we actually have a group of people slated to do the Penelope kidding. We don't have anyone here to do this, so if you feel like doing some SMT kidding, talk to me. Okay, next is the chassis. This is a really ugly picture because this is the only one I had when I made this up. This is unpainted. We have 2 painted ones in the Tapper booth, and it's powder coat black, came out really nice. This lid comes off. This looks like a DX60 from years ago with about 40 screws all the way around the outside. So if you don't want to have to take all those out to get your boards out. So there's no rail across the top here. This cover has an L on it, and there's a piece of foam glued in the top. When you screw the six screws in, that holds your boards firm. If you take that six screws out, you can lift the boards vertically out. So you don't have to take 400 screws off to get at your boards. You can see the LPU power connector sticking through here. Over on this side is an inside inboard fan to suck air in, blow it across. This cutout here is for Alex, and you mount Alex inside its own case inside this unit, so it's shielded from all the rest of the components inside the case. And there's still enough room up in the front to put a penny whistle or other PA, as such will come out later. 92 millimeter, sort of standard cooling fan. I didn't like 80 millimeters because they're too small and 100 millimeter won't fit, so 92 is the nearest standard size. And pretty much covered all of these. The rear will be silk screened with all of the nomenclatures for the Alex, so what antennas go where, what transverter connections there are. So, okay, Tentec's building these. Show of interest is completed already. The order has been placed for these, so you will be able to order these on the Tapper website about the second week in June. Price is $99, by the way. Okay, a few other boards. Penelope's are now available from GERD. Like I said, he has a three-slot backplane. He also has this antenna TR switch and 6-meter LNA, and he's working on the 100-watt PA. And if you want to write this down, this is his email address. He takes orders via email. Come see me in the booth if you want to. If you're not quick enough, from quicker than my finger. There's a picture of that low noise figure, 25 dB gain. And these are available now, the TR switching board and LNA. And you can pull the LNA out and put it in a box and use it separately. That's kind of cool. Okay, and this is his 100-watt PA prototype. And the interesting thing I thought was, down here he has an interface for a little LCD display, like a two-line text display. So you can read SWR and power and current and things like that with an onboard PIC, which I'm not sure where it is. It's probably down. Anyway, he has an onboard PIC that drives this LCD, probably this chip right here. Interesting. Architecture. Phoenix, this is a QSD QSE transceiver basically. So this is kind of like a soft rock receiver and also a QSE exciter, all on one board, plugs onto the Atlas bus. Again, this is a ways out. This is in alpha testing right now. They're having a problem with the synthesizer with this DDS here. Okay, Hermes, this is what I talked about a little bit before. This is a very ambitious project. This is going to be a Penelope, Mercury, USB interface, 20-watt PA, everything on one Eurocard, 100 by 160. I don't know how in the heck he's going to do this, but hey, you know, if he can do it, I'll buy one. It'd be great.
1 minute.
1 minute, okay. There's the block diagram, just in case you want to check your eyes, glasses out. Odyssey. Low power handheld SDR, this is a Suitset project, also known as a Suitset, and I swear I saw that guy out on the flea market today. But you can see this hardware actually over at the AMSAT booth. They got it on display over there. Thor, the high efficiency class EPA, they're still talking about this. The thing that really makes this exciting is that a lot of the envelope adjustments, shall we say, that we need for class EPA, we can do in the Penelope because, hey, it's just a D to A, right? Just software. Okay, and this is a sample 160 meter class E amplifier that Phil VK6 APH breadboarded up. He claims this is the most stable amplifier that he's ever built. He can short it, he can open it, he can't make the thing crap out in any way. Uses a junk box transistor out of his parts bin. Okay, Gibraltar, GPS discipline frequency standard. You can see why this is gonna take a little bit of time. It's complex, but you'll get a lot of features out of this for the time nuts amongst you. Same with Demeter, lots of features. UPS support, battery charger support, fan controller, variable speed fan controller. It's going to take a little bit of time to get this going. DSP backend, you can run your HPSDR without a PC. Okay, never mind swine flu, you might have SDR fever if you have no use for knobs. You think IQ has nothing to do with intelligence. You see nothing wrong with Rig Here is Core 2 Duo. And you're still awake after all of this.
Okay.
So one more thing.
Yeah.
You've all seen this, right? Well, there you go.
Scotty is going to be over in his booth. I'm sorry we won't have time for questions because we're running way behind. Let's give Scotty a big hand. Okay, so we've often had these SDR forums, but we've yet to have, how do you use them? How are you going to use them practically? So, thank you. So I was beat up my buddy over here, the president of AARL, Joel Harrison, to come and tell us how he does operates with his SDR, his Flex 5000. In contest, DX, low band, whatever. This guy operates from 160 meters to 47 gigahertz, and he's probably got a light whistle in there or two. We've built a few antennas together, and he's a really smart, good guy. Why he wants to be a politician, I don't know. W5ZN.
Thank you very much, Bob. Well, I don't consider myself a politician. But I have to tell you, I really love these names that we give a lot of these projects. I guarantee you, if I were to get on in a contest with a Sasquatch, I'd have a clear frequency for the entire contest. There we go. All right, I'm Joel Harrison, W5ZN, and before we get started here, I just want you to know I'm not a software engineer. I'm not a computer engineer. I receive no commercial compensation from Flex Radio. I don't work for them. I use their products, and I'm going to tell you how I use them and the results that I get on the air from them. But a lot of these results are going to apply to a lot of the SDR projects that you see that we have going on. Software-defined radios offer flexibility beyond imagination in what you can do. And what I'm going to tell you is how I've actually used these at my station. Now, professionally, I work in the nuclear power industry, and I have about 28 years of experience in ultrasound and wave theory technology, as well as that same amount of time looking at echoes and signal responses on CRTs and computers. So when I get a Panadapter in front of me, I'm just in heaven when I get to see all of that. And I also sit on the board of directors of the Arkansas Science and Technology Authority. Probably most important of all, though, is that I'm a ham, and you know, I'm a DXer. I like to contest, and I like to do what I call extreme operating. I love operating on the low bands, 160 and 80 meters, which is the extreme end of one end of our bands. And as Bob said, I like to operate up on the microwave bands at the other extreme. So I'm kind of one of the guys that if you come up with a good design of a radio and you want to put it out for a test drive, I'm going to take it out and test drive it and let you know how well that it performed. I want to take this opportunity, though, to thank all of the guys that work in the SDR area and design this stuff, and especially Gerald, who has done more for software-defined radios commercially and has given me tools to use at W5ZN that are just fantastic. So I thank you for that. And I thank my good friend Bob McGuire, who, when I start whining and complaining about something, he whips up a quick fix for it. I own two SDR 1000s from several years ago. I do own a Flex 5000 as well that I use. And if you want to find out a little bit more about some of my contest accomplishments and DX work and what I do, you can go to my website and pick up a lot of good stuff like that. But to keep Bob happy, I have to kind of keep him calibrated as well. Get him down to the house and treat him real nice every now and then. So there he is, lounged out at my desk, eating M&Ms and drinking unidentified liquids over the weekend. So
With Al Ward.
With Al Ward, that's correct. Al is a good friend of mine that does a lot of helps me test drive a lot of these radios. Well, let's take a look at some of the myths and facts right quick about software-defined radios. Number one, an SDR will not make you a superior operator. That is not going to happen, okay? You're still going to have to acquire that skill through experience working on the air. So don't think you can walk over here and buy a big software-defined radio from anyone and automatically go back and just be killing everybody else on the bands. It's not going to happen. What it's going to do is it's going to provide you with enhanced flexibility in what I call a multifaceted tool to utilize those skills to the fullest. But you need to just keep things, and this is a phrase that Al coined as well, that anywhere, and I'll throw this out to all of the SDR designers, you know, a question, is it morally acceptable to fix a hardware issue with software? So whatever hardware components that you have to go along with your software-defined capabilities, you know, make sure that they're designed well. Because the last thing that we really need out there is to have to start trying to fix or hide some hardware deficiencies with software. The number one thing about software-defined radios that I just absolutely love is the pan adapter. And as I said, my familiarity is with PowerSDR. And of course, everyone's familiar with this screenshot. And I guess this is skin classic now, Gerald, since we have all of the new skins. Ugly Betty, you know, Ugly Betty Classic or something like that. But I just love, you know, being able to have this pan adapter, and there are a number of reasons why. Number one, you can see what's going on. Now, I told you that I have many years of experience of looking at echoes, looking at signal characteristics on a CRT on a screen. So when I got a pan adapter, I was just in heaven. But it also opens up another dimension for you. Right now, we use one of our senses, and that's hearing, and that's it. That's all we've had up until this time. Now, you can use not only your ears, but your eyes as well. So you have increased your ability, your operating ability, by 3 dB. Okay? You've doubled that by doubling the senses that you can use. One good thing about a software-defined radios as well is it gives you the tools to do antenna and signal analysis, and I'm going to talk about that in a little bit. And you can also perform detailed and accurate calibration and test measurements, and I think the Flex 3000 kind of does its own thing, right? It can do itself, so to speak. So what's going on here when you try to find a station? One thing is this, the pan adapter and the display is a real-time display. It's crisp, it's clean, it's fast, and it's accurate. Now, a lot of the displays that you see today that like to show you a spectrum, they're not a tool. They may be good for you, but they just don't provide anything for me. They don't look real time, the scan rates are slow, and they're just not there, as I said. One of the things with having a pan adapter where you can see signals over a wide spectrum, if you get into a DX pileup or you're trying to work a DX station and they're working split operation, you can actually go and see what's going on around you or above the station and actually see the station that's actually calling the DX station to get on his frequency, as long as you don't have someone that forgets that when the DX is transmitting, he's not supposed to transmit. And when you have a DX expedition going on, you see a lot of things like that. Rare multipliers in the contest. Where's Doug Grant? Has he left? Good. Because these guys that use analog radios that want to whine every time somebody comes up with a new tool to use probably would want to do something about how I find rare multipliers in a contest. I don't use skimmer. I don't need skimmer. I don't need packet. I don't need any of that. I have my SDR with my pan adapter, and I guarantee you, if I'm on a run frequency and a rare multiplier comes on, I'm going to see it, because I'm going to see 25 signals pop up the band where that guy is. And I know it. I see it. And that's a tool that you can use. It's very good, very effective too. Microwave operation, Phil sitting down here, Phil knows that nobody's LO is on the same frequency. You know, I don't care how many 10 meg sources you have. I don't care, you know, nobody's ever on the same frequency. Al Ward always tells me I'm the one that's off frequency, all right? But you can see the signals. You don't have to waste time floating around to try to find out where everybody is. All right, I mentioned antenna and signal analysis. You have a calibrated dBm scale on your pan adapter. And it also has a feature of a peak hold where you can click it and you can get a peak of that signal, and that allows you to make antenna comparisons. Now here's an example. Last fall, I have a number of low band receiving antennas. I have 880 foot beverages. I have a modified K9 AY loop. I have a new antenna system that Bob designed that he helped me with, which is an 8-circled vertical array, which is 8 shortened verticals in a 320-foot diameter circle that uses an in-fire broadside configuration, rotatable in 45-degree segments for 160 meters. All right. So when we put this thing in, you know, we wanted to actually do some evaluation on the air and compare it to my beverages, compare it to my loops and all my other receiving antennas that I have and my verticals. That is a piece of cake with a software-defined radio with power SDR. And here's an example of some of the measurements that we made. Here is our signal level here in dBm on the left, and this is just time starting at 0215, you know, out to about for about 30 minutes. The station I was listening to, this is on 160 meters, was JW/OZ1TCK on Svalbard Island. So what I was able to do is I have a rather complicated switching network where I can you know, switch very quickly between antennas, combine them, and do all kinds of things to different receivers. So here is a comparison. The yellow is the vertical array, the blue is the beverage, and the red shows my noise floor. And you can see over time how these two antennas perform and plot this chart. Now, all I simply did was record down the actual signal levels and plug this into Excel to do this chart. This wasn't something that came out of PowerSDR. But you have the tools to do this, and I have probably two dozen charts of various DX stations on 160 meters from this past season comparing these antennas. And that was made possible because I have the flexibility with Power SDR to do that. I want to talk a little bit about contest operation as well. You know, every radio, of course, goes through a barrage of lab tests. And, you know, I like Rob Sherwood's focus on things here. He said lab tests are important, and they are, but radios also need to be evaluated in a contest environment. Now, a while ago when Doug asked how many of you operate seriously in a contest, there were many of you that did. And there's a reason for that. The band is just full of stations. I mean, there are stations every couple of hundred hertz all the way up the band on CW and spaced proportionately for single sideband contests. And you're going to have loud stations next to you, and you only want to hear the ones that are important to you. And 99% of the time, the signal that's important to you is going to be real weak. He's just going to be a couple of dB out of the noise. And the SDRs really can provide excellent performance to not only pull weak signals out amid strong signals, and that was why I made that comment a while ago. If Doug said, you know, can you hear a weak signal next to a 100 dB signal or something like that. And you know, from what my experience has been, you can get pretty darn close depending on how clean the guy next to you is. But the more trash that you have on the band, the quicker you're going to fry your brain for 24 hours, 48 hours in a contest. You're sitting there listening to this stuff, and you need a good receiver that's got low noise, that doesn't have intermod distortion. And we saw some numbers about the intermod distortion and so forth at 2 kilohertz and so forth. The third order products. If you will look at receivers now and compare them to what we had 20 years ago to what we have today, it's just unbelievable at how the technology has improved for us to be able to stand on a frequency and do fine amid strong stations. We don't have intermod distortion like we did. We don't have problems with a lot of things that we used to have. In the ARRL DX contest this year, there were I got in the middle of a run with some Germans, and I found out that they always send in that contest, they send their power level as their exchange, your signal report and a power level. And the guy sent that he was sending, that he was running 5 watts. Now, if you're living in Arkansas like I do, and you're trying to copy a 5-watt station in Germany on 80 meters in the middle of a contest, that takes some doing. I had a station on either side of my run frequency. One station that was only 150 hertz lower than me. Another station that was about 200 hertz higher than me. Now, I can tell you with my FT-1000 Mark V that I used to run on HF in these contests, it was impossible to copy a station like that. Impossible. Couldn't do it. There's no way I could have copied a 5-watt station out of Germany amidst two strong stations adjacent to me. But I can tell you, not only did I work that station, I think he got on the phone and called the Bavarian QRP Club, and they all got on the air because I had a string of about 30 of those guys that I worked during that time. Some of them were pretty rough working, given the environment, but I was able to pull them all out. As a comparison, I hold the W5 record on 80 meters in the ARRL International DX contest on CW. The most QSOs that I have ever been able to pull out before this year was just shy of 400. Now, that's pretty good from Arkansas. If you live on the East Coast and you only work 400 stations, you got on the air for an hour and then went to bed. That's not the case in Arkansas on 80 meters. This year, I worked 685 stations. I was able to hear and work all of those low-power European stations with dipoles in their attic that I never could hear before. And it was all, I credit that to the receiver that I had and the ability to have all of these distortion products and noise and interference from adjacent stations. Another advantage about this is, if you're calling CQ and you think the band's dead, you don't have to worry about trying to tune all over the place to see if it actually is. You just look on your pen adapter and see. Look on the screen. If you're doing search and pounce, I usually turn up the band real slow and, come across a station, I'll hear his call, I'll check to see if I've worked him or not. If I have, I'll move on. If not, I'll continue on. I can't tell you how many times since I started using the 5000 and using my pan adapter to where I could see, after I went past an area that I could no longer hear, that may only be 500 hertz behind me, I saw a station come up that wasn't there when I tuned past it. Having that second sense allows you to go back, look at that station, and find out who it is. And that helped improve my QSO rate as well. Run frequency, if you're sitting there running a bunch, just like I said, I'm running all of these low power DLs, I can see who's on either side of me. I don't have to stop running and tune around to see who is either side of me and what's going on. I can see it, and I can adjust my filters if I need to, very quickly. I can make adjustments to my operating parameters because I have the ability of that second sense. I can see them now. I don't have to just simply rely on my eyes. SO2R, we got to work on this, all right? Now, I know a lot of SDRs are advertised as SO2R ready. They're close. Still need a little work on SO2R, but we at least have an advantage is we already have a second receiver and it has the exact same abilities as the main receiver. But that still needs a little work. Gerald talked a lot about diversity reception and he mentioned W9OY's website. And here's the link to his blog. Now, diversity reception is just an amazing tool that I'm glad we have now. And it's a tool, thanks to the fact that this is a software-defined radio, I don't have to buy a new radio, I don't have to send my radio back to the factory to have this put in, I simply download it and start using it and reading the instructions. Power, and Gerald touched on this so I won't go into it in detail, but W9OY, read what he's written about it. I mean, you're talking about nulling out 50 dB signals that are giving you a problem. You have a noise source from a particular area that's bothering you, you can null it out. And I have, multiple antennas and I'm able to switch them and combine them and do diversity reception to some extent. And I'm really excited to, have an opportunity here to try this here very, very soon. Digital operation, man, look, Ma, no cables. I ran off and left some photos I was going to show you in this presentation at the house. You should see the pile of cables that are in my floor, still sitting in my floor. When I took down everything that was interconnecting my radios, my computers, all of my digital interface stuff. I don't have cables anymore. With a software-defined radio, your computer's running it, you use virtual audio cables. Pseudo cables, they're not really cables. Interconnections within the computer. That reduces the RF interference that you're gonna have, radiation issues you may have from the cables. And I sit there and run MixW, I run the JT suite of software, voice keyers, K1MM logger. I can even run Skimmer if I want to. I have it set up where I can run it, it's just no benefit. But no interconnecting cables. And that in itself is a reduction in the stress factor of trying to interconnect all of this equipment and then try to figure out what cable's what. Third-party applications, if you do have something that needs to be utilized outside of the computer, one of them is I have a number of automatic antenna switches that are the Ameritron RCS-12s, and they can be controlled from your radio. Well, my radio is a computer, of course, the SDR, so I have to have a way to interconnect the output from my computer to that third-party application or to that antenna switch. And what we have is a little program that who wrote the program? Steve Nance. Yeah, Steve Nance wrote, which is DDUTL. And it provides external control of just about anything you want to control through a parallel port or through a serial port on your computer. VHF, UHF, microwave. Just briefly, one of the great things I mentioned about being able to find a station because of the PAN adapter, you can go in to your power SDR console and actually enter your local oscillator frequencies and actually have direct frequency readout on your power SDR screen. And you can also add in an offset. If your LO is off frequency by a kilohertz or two, you can program that in so you won't be way off frequency anymore. And again, the PAN adapter allows you to look for frequencies that are that may be off station. All right, filters. We're going to talk about filters here. All right. The question is, does NRAD sell filters for the SDR? Anybody have any idea? Huh? They're free. That's right. Well, they're not free. You're paying for it, but they're in the radio. That's not the big deal. Radios come with filters. But what happens if you don't like the filter you have in your radio? You gotta open it up and buy another one and put it in there. No, you just adjust this one. You know, it comes with preset filters, but you can adjust it too and have variable. You don't like the filters that are there? Do your own. It's great with filters. And that's why I said during a contest, you can modify your station parameters. Knobs. Oh man, no knobs? It doesn't have knobs? I don't, I have to have knobs? You must fear the knobs and worship the knobs. You know what I say? Screw the knobs. You don't need them. And I don't know why in the world, and I still hear guys who will buy a software-defined radio and a computer and then say, I need a knob. And I know one guy that went out to Radio Shack and bought a stupid knob and glued it to the front of his SDR 5000 just so it could look good. Well, I don't even see my SDR 5000. It's sitting back way out of the way. I don't even need it. You don't need knobs. Don't need them. Do everything in the world that you need to without them. All right. Well, that's some of the things that I utilize mine for, some of the advantages that it provides me. And I guarantee you, you've got to take the time to know your station, to know your location, to know what you have, and tailor this to suit your style of operating and your needs. But that's the beautiful thing about software-defined radios. You can do that. They're very flexible. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you all for coming, and see you next year.